Okay, just good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today, I'm just talking about very just practical, just topics like Mega Foundation. I'm starting the Mega Foundation this morning class and then afternoon class, and maybe I can give you some idea, especially come from some practical side. Maybe you can think about some my just presentation this morning. And then you can have some kind of idea how to solve these kind of problems in your country. I'm starting the Mega Foundations here, Three Shaft first, and then Bindraft Foundations. Yesterday, Dr. Ashishi students talking about some experimental testing, so Bindraft, but still, I have several materials on that foundations, and I can show you this afternoon, including some computer just exercise program. Starting based on some this kind of procedures over here, especially I am showing some kind of case studies we performed on Incheon Grand Cable Stage Bridges. Actually, at the time I consulting some kind of some geotechnical just side for the Samsung just construction company at the time, and we can make it possible, and since then still just the bridge is working safely and economically, and that's why I'm showing that the exact the designs just viewpoint at the time we are just talking about, and I'm showing you and you can share this kind of idea. Okay, the same figure, the mega structures here. This is high-rise buildings and also some grand bridges, especially in civil engineering. And as I told you, the high-rise buildings and the grand span bridges, we have some common feature. It's a mega structures and urban and offshore areas. And how to solve this kind of problem? Just I can say, first starting. Using Bindraft foundation or large size drilled shaft. So starting this one first, and then second is the Bindraft this afternoon. Three shaft. This figure showing the picture just the Lotte Jamsil Super Tower. It's around 2 years ago. We just constructed up to 123 stories, about 555 meters from the ground surface. And then I had a chance to see the base rocks, to share some bearing effect of some these buildings. And that time, just this is the final. Just bearing just the stage of the rocks. We called it, we are divided into several zoning, and we had a phase mapping to identify some geological, some kind of some features of this site. I'm taken. This is the final, just people starting some foundation. This is the final, just phase mapping, just picture. Taken at the time, about 70 meter and 70 meter square, like a square. So this main tower is located in this site. The other is a podium and the other some auxiliary building. The miscellaneous building is there, but still on this part is 123 story just site. And then, as I told you, there are some ports distinctively we can find out over here. And there is some kind of some geological just features, but still I'm just showing some kind of this kind of some plan view of this site. Now starting, how can you handle this kind of some large size of foundations first? There are some records on the ultimate bearing capacity. Every day, the day before yesterday, we are talking about ultimate bearing capacity several times. It's defined when, in case of a large diameter or large size of a grain just piled up, it looks like the settlement is almost less than 10% of the width of the whole mega foundations. We can define the ultimate capacity when the settlement is less than 10% of the whole footing width. In this case, the Jamshi, there is a 70 meter and 70 meter. So 10% multiply some 70 meter of raft. The settlement just at the time correspond to settlement over here, we can define the ultimate bearing capacity. So for the single pile, maybe you remember in first quiz, I asked what's the formula of the single piles for the ultimate capacity. Is the answer corresponding to the large size pile over here, pile drop to any kind of some footings, is like, looks like here. It's the same, just the equation, but still there are some other factors, including for the pile portion and some raft portion. So there are available some factors over here. Maybe you can refer to this one I'm showing, but still somebody already proposed this kind of some capacity values over here. And if the footing is just becoming just larger and larger, maybe we can expect some kind of some flexible foundation, right? Yesterday I'm showing some kind of some wet foundations on springs. Maybe you exercise some kind of some foundation time, that's so flexible. That's why you can handle by some numerical analysis, and I have a showing some kind of some programs you have practiced yesterday. And becoming larger and larger, the deformation of a foundation. So I mean the deformed this footing compared to the rigid just the foundation also is a non-uniform distribution of the settlement and some kind of contact pressures compared to the rigid foundation. Also, in this case, due to the some kind of some deformation, foundation, and some contact pressure, that must be coupled between some foundation and the soil. We call this coupled, means there is some connection, interactions between foundation and the soils and some superstructures, all the interacted with each other, compared to the uncoupled between the foundation and the soil for the rigid foundation. So there is a difference between a rigid and flexible foundations. And this is some exaggerated some forms of the rigid means is something like stone, something like some kind of this original just shape can be changed in case of a flexible foundation, right? I'm showing some kind of some deformed some shapes of the just in the analysis. That's why I'm showing the mesh. But anyway, it's a deformed shape compared to original one. So if the foundation is larger and larger, and the foundation can be flexible, and there is some action of the footings, is a bending plus some membrane action. To in this just some foundations. So I included this kind of a bending option, beam element, plus some kind of some membrane options in the analysis of these just flexible foundations. So schematically, the rigid is a left figure. The deformed shape is looks like that. And flexible is deformed, it looks like this kind of some just shapes we expected compared to the some kind of some rigid, it's something like that kind of some deformed shapes you can think about. So starting large diameter of some drill shaft, physically is larger. It's in most cases one meter approximately starting and 2 meter and 3 meters. In the real field up to now, just we have a 3 meter by just drill shaft constructed in the real field. In Asia, and domestically, we have some record over there. So this pipe is just penetrating into the soil and then finally rock socketed to where? We called just the weathered rock and then soft rock and then hard rock. So depending on the loading and some soil conditions, we can bearing the bottom of this one in these rocks. So we call this a rock socketed. I'm showing the rock socketed. So in this case, the resistance of this drill shaft can be resisted by the skin friction and point bearing resistance. So in this right figure showing some kind of some resistance versus some settlement of that drill shaft, and then for the shaft resistance, it looks like this kind of behavior. And this point resistance must be this green color behavior. So how can you design this kind of just a different value of shaft and tools? We must compare what's this is the physical summation of this one? No. It depends on some kind of deformations over here, settlement here. In case of a shaft, there is a very low just displacement. We can expect a higher skin friction, but still just the toe resistance is the initial starting point, right? So to mobilize the toe resistance, we must have a higher settlement. So that means there is a larger just settlement we must just consider for the mobilization of the just point resistance, right? So it's not the physically the summation of these two parts, because the mobilization is first by the skin friction, and then we can expect another some point resistance, I mean the bearing resistance. So you must be careful about some kind of deformations. If the footing is larger and larger, to mobilize the resistance, we need more displacement, right? So please think about the decision, engineering judgment, based on this simple equation, but still there is some kind of different features of the point and the bearing just resistance, and what is the governing factor you must consider first. And there are many influencing factors on just point resistance. Here, it's larger. Probably it's rock socketed. There are several factors affecting the point resistance. The rock's unconfined compressive strength is very important, okay? Depend on the rock just type, we have a different unconfined compressive strength. Also, we have some different rock mass, just modulus. And there is many discontinuity, including some inclination and some kind of some difference, the spacings of the discontinuity problems. And if the pile is larger and larger, there is one of the factors affecting some point resistance. So to see the point bearing resistance, you must consider this kind of things take into account to mobilize, to calculate the point resistance, right? Depending on the situation, there are many scholars that proposed the point resistance is a simple equation, but it's very empirical, but still we are using alpha multiplied the unconfined compressive strength and beta power, okay? It's a very simple one. Still, we are using this one based on the scholars and based on different rankings, like formations they proposed to calculate this kind of Q max values, the maximum unit skin point resistance. Also, there are many just specifications, FHWA, ASHOTO, Canadian Foundation Engineering, and other just manuals they are talking about this one to calculate the Qmax. So in India, your country, you have your own rock just formations. So depending on different rocks, maybe in Korea, we have called this some kind of the weathered rocks based on gneiss bases and granite base. We have a different just unconfined compressive strength we are just expecting. So it's highly dependent on the local situations of the rock bases. So this is showing one of the Qmax evaluation. Also, we must consider the skin frictions over here. It's a, see, the skin friction. Why you see something like rock? Due to the insulation, using some kind of RCD or some kind of bit, we can make this kind of configurations over here in the skin. So depending on the original, the unconfined compressive strength analysis can be changed, like here, by considering rock, just previous rock mass, just materials and some construction conditions, some kind of initial confining pressures, pile diameters, uncompressible strengths, and another factor is the borehole roughness. So maybe compared to the just the point resistance, you must consider some kind of the borehole construction, initial confining pressure. The other thing is almost same, but still we need more some kind of some borehole roughness and initial compounding pressures to calculate some kind of just skin friction, and we call this relational design by constant normal stiffness. This unconfined compressive strength is empirical design, but still we are still changing to this state like here. But the previous research are talking about same as the Fmax. It's almost same alpha, QU, beta power. But different coefficient, empirical coefficient. You can compare the previous the point and this just skin friction values. And based on so many just researchers, depending on their own just rock just informations, maybe they proposed over here. And I'm talking about just CNS. Constant normal stiffness. Why? Due to the some kind of some lock socket portion, there is some kind of some due to the socket, there is some increase of some radius like that, and then there is some kind of some confining pressure over there. So in most case, we can just in a state of the constant normal stiffness state. So this just ratio showing the constant normal stiffness during the construction and during ongoing just the state of that piling. So like say the front one is the constant normal stiffness to make a constant value instead of some kind of only constant of the loading. This is the ratio. It must be constant. Okay, so under a increase of vertical loading of the rate associated with the dilation due to shear deformation. So you have to keep this one constant and then have some kind of some skin friction values you obtained. So there are so many constant normal stiffness conditions for the tunneling. It's some rock bolt over there and some kind of some rock bolt in the jointed rock. Also, the rock socket, as I told you here, is in a state of the constant normal stiffness condition cases. So, to have some kind of some constant normal stiffness, you must consider this kind of inference factors. Skin friction of a pile,
slope, roughness, tunneling, lock socket structures. That must be an application of this constant normal stiffness case. This is a constant normal case. It's a constant, but we are talking about constant stiffness. This is a figure. They are doing some testings on the constant. University of Monash in the Australia, same as the different university in Australia, and just my university, I also made this kind of some constant normal stiffness testings using some kind of direct shear devices, modification of the conventional one into the to consider constant normal stiffness, and just we performed so many testings over here, and based on these testings, we can define different roughness of the boreholes to simulate, and we can just have some testing and some kind of some dilations and some normal stress and the shear stress distributions we obtained based on different seesaw type of roughness of the rock bases. This is a typical picture of the RCD, the drill shaft. There is some RCD based the bit. So to check the borehole roughness, I'm just taking a picture. Also, this is the taken in the borehole due to some RCD or some kind of the drilling. There is a different value of some kind of roughness over here. Maybe in the deeper, we cannot find that because under the ground water table, we cannot see, but just shallow depths, maybe you can find out this kind of some roughness values, and we can identify that roughness using some scanning of that borehole, scanning method, maybe. Maybe you can use your own method, but I'm just using the taking out the quantification of the borehole roughness, and it's taken in front of the borehole, and we can find out some kind of the height and the length of these roughness values over here, and simulate in the laboratory to find out this kind of roughness. And finally, I just can summarize the CIDA in Australia and the other just rock types in our country is my cases, and we can make this kind of roughness in the laboratory and to identify some kind of rough. So how can I say, it's a topology like in the some borehole topology, we can identify and we can consider this kind of roughness into the calculation of the skin friction of the rock socket piles. Okay, this is some of the working we are performing in these days, and you can think about this kind of some skin friction and the point resistance values, especially in rock. And I'm showing the case study based on this kind of some informations. This is the taken over here. It's bridges, it's offshore bridges, and you see on the construction in a state early morning, we are taken the picture in the marine site over here, and this is the, we call this a pylon here, the main just the tower. It's about 800 meters from here to here, and it's a pylon like here, about 300 meters from just the water surface to the top. It's a center, there is some kind of some high tall pylon, and then approaching level is approaching is using some kind of some construction techniques you call the FCM method for this just a slab. And then the initial starting point is we call this a viaduct girders, just insulation, and using a little different techniques in the field of SLM, just launching this fabricated some slabs just one by one and have to just making this just bioduct girder part. So I'm summarizing. The bridges is connecting the existing island called Yongjong Island and is inland new town Songdo. It takes about 21 kilometers starting and only the bridges about like here. And the cable stayed bridge length is like here. The main span I told you 800 meter. And the pylon is about, looks like, 230 meter, not 300. But anyway, this one, all foundations are composed of large diameter, drill shaft. Okay, this is the, just a schematic diagram. This is Yongjong Island, international airport over here. And then, this is Songdo, new city. So there are so many bridges here, and this is the what's the main, just the pylon of this just the bridge, and then approaching, and then viaduct bubble, the portion, and then this is about 18 kilometers, 12 kilometers around exactly from here, including that one about 21, as I told you, like that. Like that. So, I'm starting. How can you design based on standard? We just obtained the Ashoto at a lefty, as I told you yesterday. The another local just specification, Korean highway bridge design code, and some other performance requirement. We can define some governing design load for the wind up to here, seismic, the intensity is 8. Looks like our case is about 1.154G level is the higher one up to now. It looks like about the magnitude is 6 point around that. We have some kind of some G value over here. The intensity is like here. There is expecting the ship infecting node over here. And we nearly want to use these bridges more than 100 years, lifetime. So this is a basic, just we applied in this just analysis and some constructions. Just think about first some kind of design code for the specific just applied road, and then we can select some kind of some foundation type, and then we apply initially in the preliminary design, apply some kind of LRFD code like showing some kind of mathematical form yesterday, and for the drill shaft, we use the Canadian foundation, also some other previous, I'm showing some F max and values based on some empirical one, alpha, QU, beta power, this kind of thing. For the vertical one, and for the lateral stability, we use some PY method. This afternoon, you have a chance to talking about some lateral loaded pile, and vertical and the horizontal. To identify that just preliminary design stages, we just also perform some kind of some pile loading testings, especially in the field. And as I told you, the Osterberg. Osterberg is one of the name, the scholars for Osterberg cell test, bidirectional testing. The same meaning, at the construction site, 4 sets of pile load testings, including 11 load testings for the real pile. And then we can interpret as a result of that one, we can identify the side resistance and the base resistance based on
this just testing, so we can modify the preliminary design stages of some kind of assumption based on the empirical form and come together and making the design possible for the rock socket piles here. So this is a schematic, just a flow chart in designing stages. And this is the pile embedment scheme for the bioduct. The approaching part looks like embedding so soft rock. And then there's some information of the soils about another different types of bioduct. We call this is a pile bend structure. It's one set. How about this is a different set? But anyway, we are approaching the soft rock. And then starting over here, so about 10 meters clearance of the between this just the pile gap to the seesaw, just the ground, just the top of the water, and then about 40 to 50 meters of the embedment up to the soft rock through the marine deposit, some soil, weathered rock, and soft rock. So most of this just the bioduct is bearing in the soft rock basis, the same as the main just cable stage, just the main pile, what's that? Pylon part, we are bearing up to hard rock. I'm sorry, I could not include the bioduct only, but we have some pylon section, also we have some approaching section, and depending on the structures, the weight, we have a different basis of some bearings. Only I'm just showing just one, and then I'm just saying and summarizing. It's a condition, soil condition, rock condition, and the part, the cable staged part, is most of the part is the soft rock or hard rock, but most of the hard rock basis bearing. And the bioduct is the soft rock. Approaching is like that, the bearing part over there. Applying some kind of the LFD isotope, rock socket pile, and some kind of orthogonal testing. Yeah? This is just the soil embedment of that, just here, up to hard rock. We have some extensive just field testings. And we have some soil profiles over here, and we have some corresponding soil properties based on field testings for different sites of that ones, maybe. This is the summary. And then also rock socket drill shaft problems from starting here, and apply this just code over here. You can nearly find out what's the resistance factor of the resistance one. And I'm starting here just already they proposed some kind of factors depending on different capacities, different some parts of different by some proposal. And we have a different values of the skin friction and some kind of and bearing, and skin friction, and bearing. So depending on different, we have a different resistance factor they already proposed first. I'm just refer to this just specification. But still, we are wondering. So we have some testings, as I told you over here. Total A4 scale pilot test. But still, we have some kind of 2 cells per pi, you know, 3 pi. So total 11. Ultimate loading test for the bidirectional loading test. And this is one of the specifications we already know about the bearing capacity. We are just report to this just standard settlement starting just 25 millimeters for the elastic and the different settlement. Also, some kind of horizontal part is we are using
this just a short LRFD is 38 millimeter, the maximum. In most case, we are just refer to this one. Maybe you also, you can use your own just well, specification. Anyway, and just we are based on this just specifications and the bearing, starting the resistance factor is for the end bearing is 0.5. Skin friction is depending on different, we have different factors we used. And finally, the capacity is the field just testing result multiplied factor proposed by here. And they applied to find the resistance of bearing capacity of that. For the seismic part, in the specification, the resistance factor is 1.0, but we just reduced up to 0.9. Just that. And then we don't consider groove effect because just most of the specification, the center to center spacing is greater than some kind of some 3 times the pile diameter. But this specification, they must consider less than 3D is a groove, is less than the single pile. But in our cases, it's all the bearing in the rock. So not consider the efficiency of the load bearing capacity of pi. Also, our cases is the spacing is greater than 3D, also in the rock basis. So we don't consider any other groove effect over here in the designing purpose. So this is the just in the initial stage, we can just think about up to now, just starting just in load testings here. It's a main, just a main tower area. Before we have some load testings in site, and we have some kind of soil information on this area. And here we have two, and the west, east, 2 to 4 loading test first initially. So one is the is east part is 3 meter, and another one is 2.4 diameter. The western part is the 2.4 and 2.4. So bidirectional testings at the bearing part over there. This part is located in the hard rock basis. Some part is located in soft rock basis for the 4 different test piles over here. So what this is a recorder. We just have a test up to here. But the company, the you know the very famous just testings performed this kind of one. And our cases is about this amount of loading, and just this is the number one. What they are talking about, some kind of the recorders they performed, and then Korean case was at the time was the highest one they are talking about, and they were just here. So based on just testing, so we are starting in detail. How to define the ultimate bearing capacity? Maybe preliminary, I'm showing the simple equation. That's the equation. But still, they are asking some kind of some specs over there. The Ashoto, FSWA, another just methods they are proposing to identify ultimate bearing capacity. So first starting for the test files over here, 4. And then we just calculate based on the proposed method over here. And finally, to identify ultimate bearing capacity, unit bearing capacity, we are just assuming we have tentatively load corresponding to the settlement of 1% of D. There are many just guys of 5%, 5%, 3%. Looks like over here. So our cases is just we are defining the ultimate bearing capacity is the loading corresponding to the settlement of this just
1% D. So, based on just judgment, we can identify all the testing result for the whether drug, soft drug, hard drug. And then you can find out the test result. The skin friction, base, the point resistance for different rock bases. It's all the most of the part except the someone based on the field testings, okay? So this is the real values obtained based on some identification. And then finally, there are some ranges over here. So you can see the my lecture note. Finally, we proposed here, specifically for these different rocks, for the skin friction, for the just the point resistance, like here. This is the real value we used in the final just detailed analysis part. And then we have some testings, sampling at locations for the wet drug, soft drug basis. We just select the samplings and then have some testings to see what the rock types working behavior like here. This is the result. And then to calculate the capacity, finally, for the weather drug basis, looks like the behavior is ductile behavior. This is the growing and finally approaching. So it looks like this kind of behavior we called is assumed is ductile. However, hard rock is brittle. So to calculate some capacity for the ductile, for the weather drug, we are combining the end bearing and skin friction to ultimate capacity. However, in the hard rock basis, maybe you can think about this one. The embedding depth is less than 1D. Somebody yesterday told me about the rock socket depth. In the case we consider the bearing capacity is a function of only the end bearing. We don't consider the skin friction, right? However, the embedding depth, socketing depth is greater than 1, depending on this kind of some settlement. If the settlement is less than 1 centimeter, we are only consider the skin friction. We don't consider the bearing, just the point resistance. However, it's greater than 1 just a centimeter, we are only consider the end bearing. So think about our judgment. And finally, based on testings, we can identify some kind of some unit skin friction. And then finally, for each pile, we can think about some ultimate bearing capacity based on this just philosophy over here. Maybe you can just modify this one. But still, this is some kind of some, it's okay, I'm just thinking about. And then also factor of safety of the seismic, as I told you, 0.9. Finally, we can increase 0.9. We increase up here by considering the field testings. Most cases, they proposed 1. Initial stage, 0.9. Finally, we can 0.95. So they proposed the previous the researchers they are working. So finally, based on our RACS testings, and then we have a different value. Finally, we obtained. The initially, only we cite from some LRFD just the code, and then finally, we slightly change based on our testings over here. So compare these ones and the previous some suggestions in my lecture note. And also the settlement, maybe somebody asked. In this case, we are applying for the ultimate settlement is 1% of D, like ultimate bearing capacity part. The allowance is half of them for the settlement considerations over here. Capacity and the settlement, we are all setting, and we can just perform some constructions based on their suggestions, this is showing yesterday afternoon. Maybe you have this kind of flowchart again, but this is a normal one. Some kind of testing superstructures and the reaction part, and finally pile foundations is depending on strength limit and the service limit testing. We are only to consider this one and the static and the seismic cases. You can look through these steps and apply. This afternoon, you have some chance to have an exercise using this kind of group files. Still, we are using for the this just Incheon Grand Bridges also using same procedures over here, the calculation. Also, it's vertical just load testing, also some horizontal load testing. So we add more lateral pile loading tests. The same site, but different just the test site. The vertical one is only near this just bridge part. The test for the lateral loading is a little far away from here. And we select three different piles for the lateral loading tests again. And one is 2.4, 1.0, looks like that one. And then we have four different test piles to have a horizontal loading test. And to see the behavior, we have the instrumentations, strain gauges, to see the load transfer from the top to down. And the, this instrumentation, just horizontal just testings for the test pile 1 to 3, test pile 4, the construction of the drill shaft in the offshore area, for the test piles, installing some kind of strain gauge and the inclinometer. And this is the result we obtained from these testings. For the lateral displacement for test pile 1, the bending moment, like here. This is the result of the testing. And then the test pile 3, we have some kind of a loading, unloading, like a cyclic testings for the test pile 3. And just the result. This is the test 1. The black is the test. The yellow, the red one is the prediction. Because at the time, just we don't have any our own just load transfer approaches, because most of the theory based one is come from other countries. So at the time, the owner of that the bridge was the very famous company AMEC in London. They asked how to define your just lateral loading cases. So they nearly want to see what kind of just PY curves or lateral load transfer curve just is suitable in this area. They asked the Korean local just sectors, and they nearly want to see our own just load transfer curve. So that's why this is the proposed by AMEC, like the supervisor, and then this is the testing result. So just we nearly want to get our predictions, and this is the yellow, the red one is the prediction by some our approaches and some kind of some testing result. And we proposed some kind of experimental PY curves for Korean just site exactly, and like using this kind of some proposed one for specifically at this site in Incheon, we just proposed this one. And finally, like this kind of some predictions for the just the real test piles. And then based on this just testing and some curves, we can extend to other real piles to designing of that the horizontal loaded piles. I'd like to just mention tentatively the summary of this part. Drill shafts are frequently used in long span offshore bridges as a viable replacement for a, in most cases, caisson foundation in these days, with two advantages. One is the efficient load bearing capacity and easy to construct in coastal area. That's why most of in the States we are using the drill shaft for the high-rise building, also some grand bridges. So it's very frequently used in the States in Korea. Also, this bridge specifically is making an approach of a long span bridge design thanks to the full application of the, but there are just suggestions for the Ashoto LRF. We are applying, also we are applying another domestic just specification together and to identify bearing capacity and deformation of the foundation, we can say about 30,000 tons of the loading test in using 3 meter diameter foundation pile by directional loading test. Based on just testings, we can so many data for the skin friction and the point resistance bar. Thoroughly just site investigation we performed. There are 12 kilometers from starting the ocean path, which pier, bridge pier, we just investigate just the soil and some detailed just investigation we performed. That's why the subsoil properties has been successfully carried out. You spend so many money to identify the subsoil conditions in this area. Okay, it's just briefly my just explanation on the drill shaft, especially the case study held in just in the Korean site. Not too much at the time because I'm not sure at the time because I'm just involved in the middle of that just site, in the middle stage of just the construction. Here, this is the preliminary stages over here. So I mean, in the initial stages, we are using some kind of specifications just proposed by the contractor, and then some simulations, and maybe your question is not. I don't have any slides, but anyway, most of the part we are starting in the middle. The starting portion is a very basic, just site investigation we performed. I remember that too extensive investigation. We don't have any this kind of some testings in the initial stages. We are starting some kind of the work in the office. And then only starting the four sets of pile loading tests is enough, the first stages. And then we include another 11 just load testing in the middle stage during the construction, the final stage of designing purpose. So this is the initial stages. Sorry, it's taking so many years already passed, so I'm not sure, but only based on this system is the initial stage, the preliminary design stage, and then the result I'm showing the most of the one is in the final stage of the just ones. It's not easy to say that the stages at the time because I don't remember exactly. But anyway, the initial stage is not is like the same as the normal just design works just in this just in the field I mean, in most case. Due to some problems involved, many things, and then they just be careful on the site and add more testings and some examinations, all things just all together at the time. I'm sorry, just people just initial stage and then final stage. If you have some slide compared, it's okay, but still enough just slide. If you want, I'm just making the data, that detailed data, maybe I can show your questions. One of the testings performed by just Ostrovsel, the company is
The, you mean the here? I'm not a practical one side man, but anyway, well, this testing is very popular in these days. The cell, the embedding cell is just stayed in the bottom of this, just bearing. And then there is a pressure going into the bottom. It's bidirectional, just pressure. And then we can measure the reactions and some kind of some frictions and the point resistances separately. That's the main feature of the bidirectional loading test. Usually performed in the large size diameters in most cases. So in Singapore, there are so many some rock socket piles they are working for the this area construction. We are usually working this kind of testings. Many data is just available from this one. The Kobe. Kobe is a bridge company. Mm. So that's originally they performed these testings in the United States and then transferred to the other countries. So our local branch in Korea, we have the company name, but still just performed for larger than 1 meter in most cases. But that's a good question. For the lateral loading, we tried one is a real pile, the construction real pile. So in the case, it's only applied loading up to the elastic stages. And another small piles, 1.0 looks like that's all the test piles. So we push that up to larger just horizontal displacement. But only the 2.4 pi is a real pi. This is a real pi. This is 2.4. This is a test pi. So differently. But anyway, you are talking about number four. Number four is a real pi. Just this is the just the testing result to up to. What's that, 100? About the bending moment is 300. 900 kilonewton. So 90 ton. I mean, for each just boring, we have a one pile and the spacing one pile. We can connect using pile cap.
3 meter diameter. Mm-hmm. For 3 meter diameter. Mm-hmm. How many such?
What do you mean, sharp?
So you have 3 meter diameter pile.
Mm-hmm.
So that is how many 3 meter diameter piles are there under one pier?
Mm. Oh, just a second. I'm not watching. For the just the main tower, I call the pylon. As I told you, this pylon. For one pylon, we have a footings. 3 diameter. Total is 21 piles support. Yes, to the one pylon. This is the 21 group piles. I remember 21. But still, all the is 3 meters. I just remember this is so. Just maybe. Yeah, this is the biodiesel. I'm sorry. I want to. This main tower is one and one over here. This part is about 21 group piles. Each pile has a diameter is 3. How about the other approaching and some bioduct just the portion? 2.4 and 1.8 diameter piles. They are using 2 or 3 for each pier. But this just the main just tower is looks like
this one.
But compared to the Caisson foundation, still economical, still cheaper than the Caisson. Yes.
You mean the horizontal loading in the test? As I told you, 90 for the L4. How?
This is based on the standard ASTM. They also have some horizontal loading, just testings like vertical loading. This is the to have a lateral loading test. We have some reaction piles. It's a reaction piles over here. Reaction piles is a test piles. So in between, we checking systems we are just installed over here, and then based on reaction, we can apply the horizontal loading for the test piles. These are all the steel piles over here. That's 3-shaft. In case of a concrete pile, there is one or two ways you can just installing the strain gauges inside or in the front just face. During the construction in the factory, you can input the strain gauges for the only test piles. You can input the strain gauges during the construction of the curing of the concrete pile, right? That's one of the way you can usually using. Or in the field, maybe we can add a steel bar. Okay? Attaching all kind of instrumentation and matching. Inside of the pipe, we can just install some kind of rebar attaching on the inside of the pipe, I mean. This is a concrete. So we can, it's a rebar. So we can, inside, so on rebar, we're attaching all the strain gauges over there, and then just like this kind of system. Or during the manufacturing stage in the factory, you can put it over here.
This is a wire system, steel.
Especially in the underground stage, steel is not possible using the wire. It's still not working well. Fugro. Fugro is just very famous for the investigation, site investigation and something. But the loading test is a different country. You know, some kind of some GRL, Goebel, GR, or Rankinson, or GRL, because WIP testings they are doing pump, all kind of some manufacturer, just a filing company, they doing this kind of some testings.
Ocean, is it not understood as a copyright material?
Is it? Time has passed, so it's free.
Because
yeah.
Because I saw there's one university, I think in Gujarat, they are collaborating with some
local
fabric and they're making big, large diameter cell for commercial.
The company is a load test company. Load test company. Dr. Ashi told me just originally they have a patent, but in the States just is opened to all the. So I mean just please just report to my just lecture note. Maybe you have some ideas on this kind of some testing, so some designing the stages, and you can think about your own just approaches. I mean, maybe this afternoon I'm showing, but maybe this afternoon maybe I can explain. But anyway. It's a plate. Like that. So each node, they have some kind of translation and rotations. So translation means there is some tension effect over here. You mean the tension is what's that, the sagging effect for the, this kind of plate. We call this membrane effect. This plate is looks like it's a plane, right? So in the case there is some other translation rotation effect. So that means just we have for example, this node, translation and rotation, right? In three direction. It's one of the thing is some kind of tension effect over there. We call this is a membrane effect. Maybe I can show you just this afternoon again on the my just lecture material.
Yeah. During the initial file load test, if any file fails in perform its function,
very
the file may fail in the load test.
Mm-hmm.
So what it is
the failure of the file, yeah, in the driving stage? So
during the loading.
Mm-hmm.
During the load test, I guess here also load test is carried out in two stages. Initial file load test and routine file load test, and especially the routine file, after files are placed, constructed, you test the file, and if it fails,
there are several ways to reinforce the failed just filing. So it's a usual just way we can do in these days, just in the right after setting the initial stage, we can check the first the file right after just installation, and then as time goes on, usually we have 28 days later, we have a second test. We call this a restrike test. The first test EOID, end of initial driving stages checking one, and then 28 days we can check restrike. Compare this one and this one, and you can find out the file is okay or not. We can find out, right? But if you can find out, okay, it's not good, you must reinforce. But depending on the geometry, we can add more piles in the vicinity of the test pile. Maybe you can some other method to have the reinforcing, some kind of using in this case. Micro-piling we are using in these days in Korea. Piling already finished. So somebody already poured all the, just placed some kind of some base slab. It's already below the ground, but still problem. In the case, we are usually asked to reinforce using micro-piling. Yes, yes. So, It's a small just equipment. You can go into anywhere and just reinforce that one in the States.
What is the termination criteria for these files?
Seven?
Termination criteria. At what depth you drive the file?
Uh-huh. You mean the final just setting?
Yes.
Just
final this, file depth.
There are two ways we can just think about the check out the final setup problems. One is the you know the BPM blow per minute. For 1 minute just driving or some boring but pouring, there is a count over there. So, in case of a steel pile, we have a
this final 500 blow per 1 meter. So that means just one blow is 2 millimeter. Okay. So we are controlling using this one for the steel pile. How about the concrete pile? Is 5 millimeter. It's a typical one in these days. That's the one we can think about the final setting, setup, just one. 2 meter, 5 meter. It's very rigid. It's very rigid, just obligation. Also, you must compare the soil layer. Okay? That one and another, just the soil, just embedment, you must check out simultaneously. That's the way. Also, another way, maybe you know a lot, the practical side, maybe you know a lot. There are so many piles over there. We can joining. And in the construction stage, we can identify based on some working stage, maybe they are recording. So compare whole things, okay. Oh, this part is okay. At this part, something wrong. Why? It's a contour, we can see. The baseline is working 1 hour. Somebody is a little lower than expected. Maybe you can just prism, I mean. What I'm saying in English. So you can find the whole piles just is okay now, initially. And then, okay, this one must be, check this one again, simultaneously. And maybe you can find out that it's okay, no. I'm sorry, it's not easy to explain in English, but anyway, this one and another, some profiling, all the bearing, just the conditions, and we can look through the right one, I mean. Because just most of the piling, you don't know, in the evening, in the early morning, they are doing. Yeah, every day doing. But I am a director, we don't know what's going on in the outside. Come on. Every day, 100 piles is driving. Bam, 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 bam. So many equipment to come. Okay, finish. Let's go out. They go another side to have a that's the real situation in most in the real field. So as a contractor or some director must what's going on and find out. Okay, it's okay, you can wait. You must be careful about the result of the real field, maybe.
What is the difference between the designed pile line and as constructed pile line?
Yeah, yeah.
Which difference you normally get?
Yeah, so I mean, we nearly just before constructing, I can give some directions to the filing. Okay, you must bearing this pile up to this level, right? Based on our some investigation. Also, we can give this kind of directions. But they are doing, but still we know the embedding depths we can find. Because on the ground, there is some other part above the ground. So we can think about some embedment depths, okay? We can check out. And we can find out the other piles, all piles around there. One pie is a little lower than the other one. Probably you can, okay, this one has some problem. You can check out what's going on. And based on design stage and in the final construction stage.
There is, in general, there is a difference between design pile length and
aspect. Yeah, correct. Especially board pile is very, very severe. The same size, same person, performing the drilling works, different capacity.
But in the case driven pipe, you can drive till you reach this settlement as set. But in the case of bore pipe, so
the same. But anyway, dynamic testings indirectly we can check out the driven pipe and the bored pipe also. But in the drill shaft, it's not easy this kind of dynamic testing. That's why you know some non-destructive testing called cross logging test. You know, for the drill shaft, it's a 3.0 meter large diameter. It's not easy to this kind of one. So that's we have some test hole. It's a 3 diameter. So we have a test hole. And during testing, we have some kind of cross-hole testings like that. That's using some dynamic testings using the elastic wave analysis like. After construction. And then check out the quality of that the shaft. It's okay. We can pour the concrete over here. Next. Because this is a test hole, like this amount of just the diameter. So we can put some kind of some gauges, okay, receiver, to find out some cross-checking of that, the quality of that drill shaft. And then finally, to pour the old concrete or some cementing to this hole and making us just shaft. Maybe you know the cross hole logging test looks like for the drill shaft, large diameter pipes. Our regulation is first. It's very restrict. Something going down. Finally, this is the final one. We don't allow below that. This is, but in most cases, very rigid one is like we are observing this one.
Suppose in a bored pipe, even pipe, suppose it is crossing that limit 1/200. Is there any corrective measure we can apply the pressure on this side? Can we do correction in the alignment during the driving?
There is some gauge attaching on that driving just equipment. They have their own some kind of checking the verticality. So based on they are doing, based on their gauge just result, and then you can follow that one. There is no other way. So during the construction, boring, drilling, at this stage you must consider some kind of verticality. Very rigidly. That's the way we can do. The other way is not. But most of the equipment, is they have their own some kind of a verticality checking point. Yes, sir?
Could you explain
what?
How pile foundations are costlier than, I mean, pile foundations are less costlier than cushions? Because cushions are easy to install. You get some pipes on.
Because just in the onshore, maybe it's okay case. But in case of offshore, depending on the depth of the water or the embedment, maybe we need more severely big just casing in most cases. So in the case compared to the cost effective, maybe the drill shaft is cheaper than the casings, most of the case. This is one of the one thing, also on the geometry, as I told you. Maybe in the shallow depths, maybe casing is cheaper, but the more long just distance from the just water surface to the bearing arm, maybe just drill shaft is cheaper than just case 9. So only depending on the money, I mean construction fee, maybe that's one of the things we can choose to between caisson and some drill shaft. But in most cases, drill shaft is very easy to just making a just a shaft above the just water surface. We have some jacketing systems and pushing down one by one. So maybe the construction period is short and shorter compared to the caisson. So in these days, we don't use caisson. It's slightly changing the trend from the caisson to the drill shaft. This is a new trend in this. Think about the other country around here. They are using all the drill shaft. Hong Kong, they are using drill shaft. Singapore, also they use drill shaft. They don't use caisson.
This is a local
problem. It's not the near general problem. Because it's not the just the discussion in this case. Because depending on the workmanship, that's why this kind of a drill shaft or a board pile is very important to control the quality control. Right? That's the, we must carefully think about. Your case is the bottom already collapsed. That's why you don't use the end bearing. But in most other cases, if you have some good quality balls, you must consider some kind of end bearing condition. Right? It's one of the options. Maybe that's not the case of the general case you are talking about. In most cases, the other country, they are using very high quality ball, no slimes under the base. In the case, you must consider end bearing condition, right? Most of the part come from end bearing. Especially in the skin friction, there are so many just unknown factors involved in the skin friction. So most of the drill shaft, large diameter piles, they are frequently using some kind of end bearing instead of the skin friction. Or in most cases, skin friction looks like almost zero. They are assuming in the just the safe side, we don't consider skin friction, but we must consider the end bearing. That's the general trend in this thing. You're talking about the quality. Because of the quality. I know, but maybe it's not the way I can answer, but anyway, in our cases, most of the files looks like it's the softer to the just a strong basis. Going into the drone. So maybe if we control the end bearing part very carefully, we must consider the end bearing is about 3 times bigger than the skin friction in most case. Most of the time, this one is about 3 times in most case compared to the skin friction. That's the in the real cases in pile foundation. But if we regularly, if we don't use this end bearing, it's not the story we can talk about here.
Just one point.
Yeah.
Regarding in this continuation, we said if the pile settlement is less than 10 millimeters, shaft friction controls the cost, develops much faster, right? So in this case, we take fraction of the end bearing and the...
No, no, in the case, we are using only the skin friction. Because relatively small deformation, less than 10 millimeter, 10 millimeter, then must be in a state of, the loading is not going to the end, right? That's why we are using only skin friction. Yes, yes, yes. But it's greater than 10 millimeter. This drastically failed in the interface. Only we can rely on the end bearing. That's why you have some specs. So maybe you can consider this kind of some situation. This is a real situation in the drill shaft.